Yes, it's a big story from Tamil Nadu, where Amma is all set to return as chief minister. 8 months after Jayalalithaa disappeared from public view following her conviction in a corruption case by a Bangalore court, decks are now cleared for the return of Jayalalithaa as chief minister of Tamil Nadu once again. And in fact, this morning, O. Paneerselvam tendered his resignation at the Legislative Party meet. He went to the Raj Bhavan and submitted his resignation as chief minister to Governor K. Rosaiya. Governor has now invited Jayalalithaa to form a government at the earliest. It just took a few minutes for Jayalalithaa to be elected as the AIADMK Legislature Party chief. And in fact, she is now expected to step out of her Poyais Garden residence any moment. She will go and garland statues of her mentors and the party founder. And the swearing-in ceremony is all set for tomorrow. Let's cut across live to Editor South, the TS Sudhir now. Sudhir, what are the indications and how much time do we get to see Jayalalithaa, in fact, emerge from the Poyais Gardens residence after 8 months of self-imposed exile?
Well, it is going to take a while, probably up to about half hour. 1:58 is now the auspicious time that we are being told. In fact, if my camera person can just pan and show you these women who are lined up on this side of the road. And in fact, further down the road, there are people, AIADMK cadre on both sides of the road to greet her all the way as she goes up to Raj Bhavan to meet Governor Rosaiya anytime before 2:15, after which she will be going to garland the statues of MGR, Periyar and Anna. And these women have been standing here for the last 1.5–2 hours, holding pots and coconuts and flowers in their hands, essentially to greet Jayalalithaa as she makes her first appearance after nearly 8 months, ever since she came back to this house on the 22nd of October from Bangalore Central Prison. So in that sense, a big moment as far as the AIADMK is concerned, and they would hope to really reap rich political benefits as a result of the court verdict which has been in Jayalalithaa's favour. Smita?
Well, absolutely. And in fact, Sudhir, you know, the governor has also asked, obviously, according to procedures, as to the list of cabinet ministers also who will be swearing in tomorrow, along with Jayalalithaa, who will also need to be re-elected, in fact, in the next 6 months. So is she going to maintain the same cabinet that she, in a way, had handed over to O. Paneerselvam as well?
Well, there's a lot of speculation on that count, because the last 7 months have been seen as a listless administration, almost as if Tamil Nadu was in pause mode. So whether Jayalalithaa will actually cut and prune or add a new face, some new faces to that cabinet, is the speculation going on here in Chennai, because she would want to show that she means business, especially as Tamil Nadu goes into an election year. As far as her herself getting elected as an MLA, that also remains in the realm of speculation, because one MLA from Chennai has already resigned, and that fuels speculation that Jayalalithaa may actually contest from a constituency in Chennai for the first time in her political career. But given the fact that elections in Tamil Nadu just a year away, it's quite possible that she may actually even advance the polls to about November, December, in which case it could even go along with Bihar for the election. So a lot in the realm of speculation. Jayalalithaa playing her cards very close to her chest. She will really wait and watch as to how the opposition ranks actually behave, because it's a splintered opposition, and that could work to the benefit of the AIADMK.
Right.
And given the fact that the 2G ruling is also expected sometime during the end of the year, she will want to wait and watch as to which way that swings. And if it actually goes against the DMK top leadership, that could again be advantage AIADMK.
Sudhir, you know, I'm very tempted actually to draw sort of, not really parallels, but to compare two states. In Bihar, we had seen how Nitish Kumar had really passed on the throne to somebody he thought he could trust, Jitan Ram Manji. But after that gap, when it was time for Nitish Kumar to be reinstated as chief minister, there was that huge tussle with Manji not wanting to do so. Unlike that, in fact, in Tamil Nadu, we've seen O. Paneerselvam really stick to the script that Jayalalithaa, in a way, wrote for him. Take us through what happened over the last 7 to 8 months in terms of the administration, in terms of the equation between these two leaders, and what lies perhaps now in store for Paneerselvam himself.
Well, it's absolutely ironical that O. Paneerselvam, when he took oath as chief minister, was in tears inside Raj Bhavan. But probably he's the first chief minister in Tamil Nadu who actually was very happy when he went to tender his resignation as chief minister. He was all smiles when I asked him what happened at the Legislature Party meeting, and probably for the first time he spoke openly and said that yes, we have elected Amma as the new leader of the Legislature Party. So in that sense, polls apart, Jitan Ram Manji and O. Paneerselvam, in fact Nitish Kumar would have really wished for someone like O. Paneerselvam to succeed him, but that's really the nature of the politics in Tamil Nadu, especially in AIADMK, where Jayalalithaa is the supreme leader. They have posters all over Chennai which say Amma is God, and that's really the sentiment here because she's the supreme leader. There's really no strong second rung of leadership to take over from her, and that's both her strength as well as the party's weakness in the days and years to come.
In fact, that is what something I wanted you to also, you know, speak about with a greater details, Sudhir, because what is it about Tamil Nadu and its nature of politics really that we get to see this cult status driven politics, be it Amma, be it Kalangar, and the cadres, you know, the kind of loyalty that we see, the kind of stuff that we are seeing in fact behind you at the moment also as we speak.
Right, Smita, I'll just get off this stool for a moment. In fact, my camera person can continue to focus on those shots. In fact, we are seeing the first semblance of some kind of a emerging from inside Jayalalitaa's house. No clarity on whether she herself will emerge. We were told initially that 128 is the time when she will emerge. We were told subsequently that it could be 158, could be the auspicious time. But we are seeing a convoy of cars coming out of Poets Garden. We do not know whether she will also emerge in the same convoy, but yes, it does seem so. We are seeing visuals. Danny, if you could just keep the visuals there.
It does seem to be, in fact, the chief minister, the to-be chief minister's
yes,
convoy
yeah,
itself.
We are just getting the, yes, yes, we, it is the chief minister-elect's convoy. We are seeing the visuals of her television crew, which will also be the vehicle in front as they capture all the images of Jayalalithaa right from her residence till the Raj Bhavan and subsequently also to the three statues of MGR, Annadurai and Periyar. If you continue to keep with the visuals, we have women lined on one side of the street to greet Jayalalithaa as she makes her first public appearance in nearly 8 months. October 22nd was the last time the people of Tamil Nadu, the people of Chennai saw her in flesh and blood as she returned from the Bangalore Central Prison after bail was granted by the Supreme Court. And now you can see the visuals, the car in which Jayalalithaa is there just passing by.
We also see, in fact, TV crews
on her way for the first time.
Yes, Sudhir, we also see TV crews mounted, in fact, on top of, perched on top of those vehicles that are following the Jaya TV, in fact, crew perhaps. So, Sudhir, is it going to be a rally of sorts from here on now?
Well, this is a convoy of Jayalalithaa as she makes her way to Raj Bhavan, which is just a few couple of kilometers from here. She will formally go and meet the governor. Already he has invited her to form the next government and also give her the list of ministers. So it's going to be a formal courtesy meeting. But yes, as you can see in those visuals, that's the cavalcade of Jayalalithaa as it makes its way to Raj Bhavan. That was really her own television channel crew, the Jaya TV, which will be beaming live pictures all through the entire route from Poets Garden to Raj Bhavan and the three statues in different parts of Chennai. So a big moment for the people who had lined up here. They have got to see their leader, their supreme leader as they call her, in flesh and blood after a gap of nearly 8 months.
Is she expected to address people as well today, or will she keep that perhaps for tomorrow?
Sorry?
Sudhir, is she expected, is Jayalalithaa expected to address crowds and people as well today, or will she perhaps keep a speech post that swearing-in ceremony tomorrow?
What we are told is that subsequent to her swearing-in ceremony at the Madras University Auditorium tomorrow, she will go to the Secretariat where she is expected to sign a couple of important files, some crucial decisions likely to be taken to essentially convey and send the message across that the new Chief Minister means business. After which there is a possibility that she could address the press, but of course that's still not yet confirmed. There is no program now of addressing the people, but it could well be possible that while she is garlanding the statues of MGR, Periyar or Anna, especially MGR, her mentor, she could very well address the gathering. There are people who have come from all over Tamil Nadu, all the districts of Tamil Nadu, to Chennai to catch a glimpse of their leader, essentially as a show of strength, because they believe that her acquittal has really energized the cadre, and this would really pay rich political dividends in the elections in 2016.
Sudhir, stay with us. For the viewers who are joining us now, you can see those live visuals playing out on your screens. These are visuals live from Chennai, and this is the first glimpse of Amma, as she is known, or Jayalalithaa, in 217 days. Jayalalithaa, who was convicted by that Bangalore court, in fact, on charges of corruption, but was later acquitted of all those charges by the Karnataka High Court. She is all set to be sworn in again as Chief Minister tomorrow. But prior to that, today, she's just, in fact, it's been a couple of minutes, that Jayalalithaa in that convoy. She's now moved out of her Poyas Garden residence in Chennai. And you can see that long queue of people lined up along the sides of the road. That convoy, in fact, is following people, waving out her banners, in fact, her posters, pictures, and also trying to rush to the car to greet Amma. T.S. Sudhir, editor Sal, is tracking those developments from the ground. Sudhir, also, you know, for Jayalalithaa, who has this very, very authoritative style of administration, of running government, she does not interact with media persons. Media persons, in fact, spend endless days, perhaps, just waiting outside the Poyas Garden residence for a glimpse. What has it been like for her, you know, this journey, the last 8 months? How has it translated in terms of the people's mood for Jayalalithaa?
Well, it would have been difficult given that fact that her house is not a palatial bungalow, given the fact that she has completely kept herself indoors for nearly 8 months. Must have been definitely tough, but she almost had taken a vow that she would impose a self-exile on her till she is acquitted by the courts. And that really came through on the 11th of May when she was acquitted by the Karnataka High Court. So in that sense, a big moment for her. But yes, the last 8 months wouldn't have been easy. Politically, what it has meant is that there was a lot of self-doubt. Yes, there were reports that she was controlling the government by some kind of remote control. O. Paneerselvam really was not seen as a chief minister who was really delivering the goods. So in that sense, it was the administration seemed to be some kind of false mode. Let's get a word from these ladies who caught the first glimpse of Jayalalithaa. Smita, எப்படி இருந்தது நீங்கள் அம்மாவை பார்த்தீங்களா?
ரொம்ப சந்தோஷம், அம்மாவுக்காக சந்தோஷம். எங்களுக்கு எல்லாம் ரொம்ப இதுக்காகவே நாங்க காத்திருந்தோம். அம்மா
எங்கிருந்து வந்திருக்கீங்க?
நாங்க எல்லாம் மாம்பழத்துல இருந்து வந்திருக்கோம். எல்லாரும் எல்லா மாமிகளுமே மாம்பழத்துல இருந்து வந்திருக்கோம்.
எத்தனை மாமிகள் வந்திருக்கீங்க?
30-40
So these are Brahmin women who have come from the Mambalam area of Chennai. Obviously, all of you are AIADMK supporters. இப்ப போன எட்டு மாசமா அம்மாவை பார்க்கவே இல்லை. அப்போ அதுலயும் இப்போ இதுலயும் இப்ப என்ன டிஃபரன்ஸ் வரப்போது? நாளைக்கு நீங்க நாளைக்கு அவ முக்கியமந்திரி ஆக போற இல்லாச்சி?
எங்களால சொல்லவே முடியாது, அவ்வளவு ஒரு மகிழ்ச்சியா இருக்கு. அவங்களை
என்ன சொல்ல முடியாது?
என்னன்னா அவங்கள பார்த்தமே இவங்களை பார்க்க முடியல. இப்ப முதல்வரா வேற ஆக போறாங்கன்ற அந்த ஒரு சந்தோஷம், அவங்க முதல்ல பார்த்தோன்னே எங்களுக்கு ஒரு சந்தோஷம் வந்துருக்கு. வந்து பார்க்கணுமே வெளியே, அவங்கள வெளியே வர சேர்ந்து பூஜைகள் எல்லாம் பண்ணி சரசநாம சொல்லி எல்லாரும் சேர்ந்து பண்ணோம். அது எல்லாருமே
So they are claiming that they did a lot of prayers and pujas for Jayalalithaa, that she should be acquitted by the Karnataka High Court. So as far as they are concerned, staunch loyalist supporters of the AIADMK and of Jayalalithaa personally, it's a big moment for them, especially as they were given the opportunity to be the first people to actually spot her when she stepped out of her Poyas Gardens residence.
Absolutely, Sudhir. And in fact, we can see those visuals on our television screens that we are cutting in live through, of course, local channels as well. You know, on those streets, they're completely decked up. It looks like a carnival kind of an atmosphere with balloons, flags, also cutouts of Jayalalithaa, and long queues of people really waiting along the sides of the street for a glimpse, to catch a glimpse of Jayalalithaa, whose convoy obviously is moving at a slightly slow pace so that she can greet all the supporters who have queued up on the roads as well. And Jayalalithaa, Sudhir, you know, now what is next there in the program? Is she going to garland the statues and come back home? What really is the schedule like from here?
Well, the schedule is that she will first meet the governor, Rosaya. Basically, governor has already invited Jayalalithaa. He met the outgoing chief minister, Paneerselvam, when he went in to give his resignation and asked and invited Jayalalithaa to form the next government, and after which she will be garlanding the statues, and that will be the end of her public engagements as far as today is concerned. Remember, she has not been meeting many people over the last 8 months. In fact, even when on the day of the verdict, on the 11th of May, when Paneerselvam came within 5 minutes of the verdict being announced, she did not meet him. In fact, she spoke to him only over the intercom. So she has been staying aloof. The fact that there were reports of the mathematical errors in the judgment of the Karnataka High Court also was some kind of a dampener as far as the AIADMK camp was concerned. But given the fact that now she has decided to take her political opponents head on, basically continuing with the line that this was a politically motivated case against her in the trial court and thereafter in the Karnataka High Court, and even if it is going in appeal to the Supreme Court, Jayalalithaa and the AIADMK have decided that they are going to take it head on.
Well, so then, you know, I'm very curious to know, as you mentioned, that very interesting fact that O. Paneerselvam also, she had actually spoken on the intercom, and it's not like a Paneerselvam went inside Poyas Garden. who are the people really who are closest to Jayalalithaa today, that when the chief minister, or when in fact the chief minister to be, when she was in exile, who were the people really around Jayalalithaa that she was interacting with?
Well, there was a group of bureaucrats, retired IPS and IAS officers, who were kind of formed into some kind of a group to actually run the administration and, in a say, quote unquote, advise the chief minister. But Paneerselvam is of a very different breed than someone like Jitendra Manji. He did not like being called the chief minister of Tamil Nadu. He did not occupy the office of the chief minister. Even in his previous avatar as the chief minister in 2000-2001, he did not occupy the chamber which was earlier occupied by Jayalalithaa. So in that sense, an extremely low profile person. As I said, he was beaming from year to year when he was going to give his resignation to the governor at Rajbhavan. You don't really find too many career politicians like that.
Yes.
This really is indicative of the kind of strong control that Jayalalithaa wields over her party. There is really no strong second rung of leadership, and she is the one who calls the shots. And in a sense, AIADMK is Jayalalithaa and Jayalalithaa is AIADMK. There is really no one else in the party who really counts for much.
Absolutely. You know, it's a demigod-like of a reception, which we can see, in fact, in those visuals right now coming in from Chennai after 217 days. This is Jayalalithaa's first public appearance. 67-year-old Amma, who will swear in as the Tamil Nadu's chief minister once again tomorrow, but for now she is on her way to Governor K. Rosaiya's residence, where she will be meeting the governor. And you can see how people have been waiting for hours to catch a glimpse of Jayalalithaa. The streets of Chennai really crowded, traffic coming to a halt. How much of the traffic has really been diverted today, Sudhir, in Chennai? The traffic normally there is much more disciplined than compared to, say, the national capital city of Delhi, but today it seems to have come to a halt.
Well, I think Chennaiites had kind of mentally prepared themselves for the 22nd of May and even tomorrow when the swearing-in will take place at the Madras University Auditorium. In fact, since yesterday we have been seeing that all the streets, in fact, especially from Forest Garden to the Madras University Auditorium to Rajbhavan, are completely filled up with Chennai Jayalalithaa's posters. In fact, if it's a newcomer coming into Chennai, he would think that the city is called Jayalalithaa City. It's that kind of bombarded, carpet bombing of Jayalalithaa posters, because they have found in this an opportunity after about 7 to 8 months that they can really go public with their adoration, admiration for their leader. Traffic obviously completely stopped. Jayalalithaa is high on the security list, so obviously the police not wanting to take any chances. In fact, this entire area, there is nobody allowed to come this side. It's only after she has left that all these people have been allowed to come this side of Forest Garden. This is an area where there is always a sea of khaki, and especially when yesterday evening we had come here, we could see more than 500 to 600 policemen deployed in different parts in every street and every nook and corner of Forest Garden. So in that sense, it's a completely a police takeover as far as this area is concerned, and that would really be the state of affairs even from Forest Garden to Rajbhavan and to Spencer's Road and the other parts of Chennai where she will be going to garland the three statues.
Absolutely, Sudhir. I know the Tamil Nadu politics is just so fascinating, where the leaders have enjoyed this cult status. A lot of leaders, in fact, also have come in fact, from film industries. They've been artists in the past. And a state which, despite, you know, oscillating between two parties in terms of the government, but the governance has always managed to continue somehow, the state has developed. So does the issue of corruption really sort of play out in people's mind in the state of Tamil Nadu, be it the DMK or AIADMK, two major parties and two of its, in fact, leaders who have been plagued by corruption charges over various times? So does that really stand as an issue, because people still worship their leaders there?
Well, yes, given it's pretty ironical, Smita, given the fact that the origin of the Dravidian movement was in the rationalist movement, and somehow this entire hero worship, treating Jayalalithaa like a demigod, is almost an antithesis to that kind of a rationalist movement. You really cannot explain that, but given the fact that most of these people, most of these party leaders really do not have anyone else apart from Jayalalithaa to help them succeed in their political careers. In fact, even during the 2014 Lok Sabha elections, Smita, Jayalalithaa, during all her election campaigns, was asking for votes for herself and the AIADMK, not really any of the individual AIADMK MP candidates. Talking specifically about the kind of bureaucracy that Tamil Nadu has been lucky to have a good bureaucracy right from the times of the Congress rule way back in the 60s under Kamraj. In that sense, that has really helped Tamil Nadu, that despite its political upheaval, despite all the political controversies, despite the fact that Tamil Nadu's voters actually vote out their government once every 5 years, they still have managed to maintain a high growth rate. Yes, the perception is that in the last 7 to 8 months, development has taken a backseat, and that's because there are many projects, whether it's a metro rail project or whether it is the inauguration of about 40 odd Amma canteens, whether it's the inauguration of nearly about 500 buses of the Tamil Nadu State Road Transport Corporation, all of them hanging fire because Paneerselvam did not really want to be seen as someone inaugurating a new project. So that was really kept in waiting for Jayalalithaa to make a comeback and inaugurating. So ribbon cutting is going to be one of a major tasks before Jayalalithaa as she takes over as Chief Minister tomorrow. She will have to inaugurate a lot of projects right from tomorrow possibly, and that's really going to be helping the AIADMK, because that will be seen as some kind of an unfurling of the welfare agenda of the AIADMK as it goes into election mode in a year from now.
Absolutely. So ribbon cutting, in fact, will be one of the topmost agendas on Jayalalitha's itinerary going forward from here. You can see those visuals of that entire convoy, which also has, of course, an ambulance or security personnel, also camera crews, in fact, from the TV station, which is promoted by Jayalalithaa, and that red beacon car as well. So Jayalalithaa now going in fact to meet Governor K. Rosaiya. O. Paneerselvam had met O. Rosaiya this morning at 7 o'clock, and the party legislature meet happened within a few minutes. The lawmakers elected Jayalalithaa once again as the legislature party chief, and O. Paneerselvam then, of course, tendering that resignation to Governor Rosaiya, who has invited Jayalalithaa to form a government along with, of course, her cabinet ministers. And those visuals are coming in on your screen from the streets of Chennai. Sudhir, also, for Jayalalithaa coming out, making this kind of a grand appearance on the streets, the message for the opposition, really, which you mentioned, is already splintered. What is that?
Well, the message for the opposition is loud and clear, that watch out, Jayalalithaa is back. Amma returns, which is our hashtag on headlines today, really means that in Tamil Nadu. But Amma returns is going to be bad news for Karunanidhi and company, also given the fact that the opposition is completely splintered. Also remember, Smita, that this optics is really meant to disillusion the opposition parties. Even on the 22nd of October, when she came back from Chennai airport, from Bangalore to Chennai airport, and then in a grand procession to Poets Garden, it was people lined up on both sides of the streets the evening of that Saturday on the 22nd of October. Likewise today, but this time today, she's coming back as someone who has been acquitted, cleared by the court of High Court of Karnataka. That time she had just come out on bail, so in that sense, she really was not really projecting a very confident persona. But this time, the optics are very clear, and it's also designed to send a message not just to the people of Tamil Nadu, but also to the people of India, and also especially to the opposition parties in Tamil Nadu.
So they're also, because we're discussing optics as well out here, how does it really work, you think? In most states, when we see rallies, obviously a high degree of management goes into it and people are brought in. But given that Tamil Nadu politics is so rooted into this cult status, these people who are lining up the streets here, they must have come in from all parts of Tamil Nadu. Would a lot of them have come in on their own, or has it all been managed by the party as well?
Well, I find Tamil Nadu politics, especially AIADMK politics, quite different from the politics which is practiced in other parts of India, whether it's in South India or in North India. Many of them pretty irrational in their manner of which they worship Jayalalithaa, and it's a very single leader kind of worship. It's not rooted in the party ideology. Mm-hmm. It's essentially starting with MGR, and thereafter that entire loyalty and devotion seems to have been transferred to the person he nominated as his successor, Jayalalithaa. So in that sense, Jayalalitha's control is absolute, and many of these people who I've been speaking to, who have come from different parts of Tamil Nadu, from places like Erode, from places even like Kanyakumari and Tanjavur, just to catch a glimpse of Jayalalithaa, you do not really find right. That kind of absolutely crazy devotion and loyalty to any leader in any other part of Tamil Nadu or of India.
So they stay with us with all those updates and perspectives, in fact, from Chennai, from where we are also getting in those visuals of Jayalalitha's first public appearance in 217 days. This is the big story we are tracking on headlines today.